Hello and welcome to another of the world's 100 greatest books from IntelliQuest. In the next few minutes, we'll introduce you to James Fenimore Cooper and his most famous work, The Last of the Mohicans. From 1820 to 1850, James Fenimore Cooper wrote an amazing 32 works of fiction. He's generally credited with becoming the first American novelist to be popular worldwide and the most significant American novelist before Nathaniel Hawthorne. Although critics complain of Cooper's stilted diction, all-too-frequent digressions, and lifeless characters, they admit that he compensates with spectacular settings, exciting stories, and vivid imagery. His work successfully depicts the American scene and Americans at all social levels. Cooper was born in Burlington, New York on September 5, 1789. He grew up in Cooperstown, New York. He was privately tutored by a clergyman, entered Yale at the age of 15, but was expelled for a prank 2 years later. At an early age, Cooper became interested in Roman classical writers such as Horace and Virgil. He also developed a prejudice against New England Calvinist Puritans and based many of his uncomplimentary descriptions of New Englanders on people he had met at Yale. After being dismissed from Yale, Cooper went to sea as an ordinary seaman and planned for a career in the Navy. Early in 1808, he received a commission as a midshipman in the United States Navy. His 3.5 years of naval service helped him write his famous sea romance, The Pilot. In 1811, Cooper married Susan Augusta Delancey, the daughter of a wealthy and aristocratic family from Westchester, New York. He became the father of 5 daughters and 2 sons. His life in Westchester County helped him write The Spy, his historical romance novel of the Revolutionary War. Cooper's novels are classified in 6 major groups. Included in the historical romance group are The Leather Stocking Tales, 1823 to 1841, The Spy and The Wept of Wish to Wish, 1829. The Leather Stocking Tales are also grouped among the wilderness novels, which include The Last of the Mohicans, 1826. The third group was the sea novels. And the final 3 groups are of Cooper's less-known works, novels with European settings, socio-political novels, and the so-called little page manuscripts. Cooper also wrote nonfiction, but it was mostly unpopular. While many writers struggle to make a living, Cooper was relatively wealthy and lived like a country gentleman. However, he ended his days bitter toward the world. He remained an individualist until he died on September 14, 1851, the day before his 62nd birthday. Now let's turn to The Last of the Mohicans, Cooper's most famous novel. It's actually another story about Cooper's fictional frontiersman, Natty Bumppo, who is the hero in Cooper's wilderness novels. Natty Bumppo goes by many names, Deerslayer, Pathfinder, Leatherstocking, and simply The Trapper. In The Last of the Mohicans, he's called Hawkeye. The Last of the Mohicans takes place during 1757 in an area of upper New York State that is a no-man's land between the English and French armies. It is the 3rd year of the war between England and France. Word has just been received that a large French force, headed by French General the Marquis de Montcalm, is heading south toward Fort William Henry, which is located on Lake Horicon and commanded by Colonel Monroe. Monroe requests reinforcements from Fort Edward, another English fort located a short distance to the south. General Webb, Fort Edward's commander, has a force of 5,000 men and is expected to send 1,300 soldiers north. Also at Fort Edward and planning to travel to Fort Henry are Colonel Monroe's 2 beautiful daughters, Cora and Alice, and Major Duncan Hayward, a British staff officer. Cooper describes the party this way. At this spot were gathered 6 horses, caparisoned in a manner which showed that 2 at least were destined to bear the persons of females, of a rank that it was not usual to meet so far in the wilds of the country. 1/3 wore the trappings and arms of an officer of the staff. They head north, guided by an Indian guide who supposedly knows a shortcut to Fort Henry. The native bore both the tomahawk and knife of the tribe, writes Cooper of the strange guide. And yet his appearance was not altogether that of a warrior. On the contrary, there was an air of neglect about his person, like that which might have proceeded from great and recent exertion, which he had not yet found leisure to repair. The colors of his war paint had blended in dark confusion about his fierce countenance and rendered his swarthy lineaments still more savage and repulsive than if art had attempted an effect which had been thus produced by chance. His searching and yet wary glance met the wonder look of the other and then changed in direction. Partly in cunning and partly in disdain, it remained fixed as if penetrating the distant air. Watching the party from a distance is a strange man who is described as having a large head, narrow shoulders, long arms, and small hands. He is well over 6 feet tall, with strong legs and thighs. On the trail is the strange man who had been watching the party. He is David Gamut, a singer and singing teacher. He demonstrates his singing ability and convinces the party to let him join them. The person of this individual was to the last degree ungainly, Cooper writes in describing Gamut. He had all the bones and joints of other men without any of their proportions. Erect, his stature surpassed that of his fellows. Seated, he appeared reduced within the ordinary limits of the race. His head was large, his shoulders narrow, his arms long and dangling, while his hands were small, if not delicate. His legs and thighs were thin, nearly to emaciation, but of extraordinary length, and his knees would have been considered tremendous had they not been outdone by the broader foundations on which the false superstructure of blended human orders was so profanely reared. Meanwhile, in the nearby forest are two men, an Indian named Chingachgook, who is covered with war paint and carries a tomahawk and a scalping knife, and Hawkeye, a muscular white man who wears a forest green hunting shirt and a coonskin cap. He has knife and a long rifle he calls Killdeer. In describing Hawkeye, Cooper writes, "His person, though muscular, was rather attenuated than full, but every nerve and muscle appeared strong and indurated by remitted exposure and toil. He wore a hunting shirt of forest green, fringed with faded yellow, and a summer cap of skins which had been shorn of their fur." When we first meet them, the two men are arguing about their heritage. Hawkeye admits that his ancestors came across the Big Sea and seized land, but points out that Chingachgook's people came from the west and seized the land they have also. Chingachgook then reminds Hawkeye that Uncas, his son, who will join them soon, is the last of a great Indian tribe called the Mohicans. At this point, Uncas suddenly appears. He reports that he has seen some Indian enemies on the trail. Then he displays his great hunting skills by killing a deer with his bow and arrow. Soon, Cora, Alice, Hayward, and David Gamut run across Hawkeye, Chingachgook, and Uncas. Hayward asks the distance to Fort William Henry, and is told by Hawkeye that the party is going in the wrong direction. "You're as much off the scent as a hound would be," Hawkeye says. Then he questions the honesty of the Indian guide, but is told that the Indian is a friend. Still suspicious, Hawkeye wants to talk to the guide, who is named Mangua. When he confronts him, the Indian takes off, disappearing into the forest. With Mangua gone, Hawkeye, Chingachgook, and Uncas agree to guide the party after making everyone promise they will remain quiet because of the extreme danger posed by Indians. After several hours, the party ties up its horses and proceeds in a canoe up a stream. After some strenuous paddling, they reach several caves situated between waterfalls called glens. "The river was confined between high and cragged rocks," Cooper writes, "one of which impended above the spot where the canoe rested. As these again were surmounted by tall trees, which appeared to totter on the brows of the precipice, it gave the stream the appearance of running through a deep, narrow dell. It seemed, in truth, to be a spot devoted to seclusion, and the sisters imbibed a soothing impression of security as they gazed upon its romantic, though not unappealing, beauties." While they eat, it becomes obvious that Uncas has his eye on Cora, the darker of the two beautiful sisters. Hawkeye has a conversation with David Gamut, and is unimpressed, thinking the music teacher frivolous. As the party rests in the caves, Cooper reflects on appearances. Uncas is called graceful and unrestrained in the attitudes and movements of nature. Though his person was more than usually screened by a green and fringed hunting shirt, like that of the white man, there was no concealment of his dark, glancing, fearless eye, alike terrible and calm. the bold outline of his high, haughty features, pure in their native red, or to the dignified elevation of his receding forehead, together with all the finest proportion of a noble head bared to the generous scalping tuft. And of Hawkeye, Cooper writes, "The strong glare of the fire fell fully upon his sturdy, weather-beaten countenance and forest attire, lending an air of romantic wildness to the aspect of an individual who, seen by the sober light of day, would have exhibited the peculiarities of a man remarkable for the strangeness of his dress, the iron-like inflexibility of his frame, and the singular compound of quick, vigilant sagacity and of exquisite simplicity that by turns usurped the possession of his muscular features." All of a sudden, a cry described by Cooper as neither human nor earthly rose in the outward air, penetrating not only the recesses of the cavern, but to the innermost hearts of all who heard it. It was followed by a stillness as deep as if the waters had been checked in their furious progress at such a horrid and unusual interruption. Nobody knows what the sound is. Hayward takes the two sisters into a safer cave to sleep. Again, the cry is heard. The next morning, just as the party prepares to leave the cave, they're fired on from across the river by a group of Indians. David is wounded, and Hayward carries him into the cave. Soon the Indians charge, and several are killed. But in the process, Hawkeye runs out of powder and bullets. He had powder and bullets in the canoe, but discovers that the Indians have captured it. When Duncan asks what will become of them, Hawkeye passes his finger round the crown of his head, indicating they will be scalped. Cora, however, convinces all but Hayward that the men should leave the girls to the mercy of the Indians and go for help. "Why die at all?" Cora says. "The path is open on every side. Fly then to the woods. Go, brave men. We owe you too much already. Let us no longer involve you in our hapless fortunes." Hayward stays behind with the wounded David, who soon recovers sufficiently. Duncan and the two girls hide in the cave. Both entrances have been covered by brush, but soon the Indians, led by Mangua, the party's former guide, find the party and brings its members out into the open. The Indians take their captives across the river in a canoe. The main body of Indians leaves, and the captives are left with six Indians, led by Mangua. As the party makes its way through the forest on horseback, Cora tries to break twigs to leave a trail for help to follow. Meanwhile, Hayward tries to bribe Mangua by telling him Monroe will reward him handsomely if he takes the girls to the fort. He thinks the Indian is impressed by the possibility of riches. Mangua is interested in Cora. He tells her that his problems with firewater are what have made him a renegade, and tells her that her father had once whipped him like a dog because he'd been drinking. He shows Cora the scars on his back, then says he wants Cora for his wife. Mangua thinks such an arrangement will avenge her father's actions, since Cora will have to draw his water, hoe his corn, and cook his venison. Cora, of course, refuses him. Angry, Mangua stirs up the other Indians, demanding revenge in blood. They fasten the captives to trees and begin to torture them. Mangua says he will save Cora's younger sister Alice if she will be his wife, but Alice says she would rather die than see her sister marry Mangua. Just in the nick of time, Hawkeye, Chingachgook, and Uncas arrive. One by one, the Indians are killed. During the battle, the shrewd Mangua fakes his death. Then, when the victory is being celebrated, Mangua escapes into the forest. "Well done for the Delaware! Victory to the Mohicans!" cries Hawkeye after the victory, once more elevating the butt of his long and fatal rifle. After David is untied, Hawkeye strongly suggests that David should part with his pitch pipe and get a weapon, but David responds that he believes in Puritanism and is opposed to violence. Then Cooper writes, "The instant David discovered that he battled with a disputant who imbibed his faith from the lights of nature, eschewing all subtleties of doctrine, he willingly abandoned a controversy from which he believed neither profit nor credit was to be derived." Hawkeye next tells the captives how they were able to find them. When the Indians had split up, horses going in two directions, Uncas was able to tell which horses carried the girls by noticing that the horses carrying them had planted the legs of one side of the ground at the same time. This unusual walking pattern, plus the distribution of the weight, tipped Uncas to which horses were carrying the girls. He also found the twigs that Cora had broken and left for a trail. The party returns to where they'd tied their horses, mounts, and after several hours, arrives at a rundown blockhouse in the middle of a clearing. In the middle of the night, the party gets lucky. 20 Huron Indians appear and are about to attack when one of their leaders finds an Indian burial mound. In respect for the dead, they withdraw. Later the next day, the voice of a Frenchman is heard, asking for their identity. Hayward replies in French, and the sentinel lets the party pass, politely saluting the ladies. A few seconds later, the party hears a groan. Chingachgook has doubled back and scalped the sentinel. Hawkeye mumbles that killing the young and friendly Frenchman might be a cruel act for a white man, but is the gift and nature of an Indian and should not be denied. Meeting the French sentinel means the party is now within French lines. They have two alternatives: try to force their way to the fort or hide until the danger has passed. To protect the girls, they decide to hide. They climb a mountain overlooking the fort and Montcalm's camp and see that the French general has filled the woods with his allies, the Iroquois Indians. Using a thick fog as cover, the party makes its way to the fort, where they are miraculously seen by Cora and Alice's father and taken safely into the fort, thus ending the first third of the novel. Soon General Montcalm begins an all-out attack on the fort. 5 days later, Hayward sees two white truce flags in the distance. Then he sees Hawkeye, who is bound and being escorted toward the fort by a French officer. Hawkeye had been captured while attempting to deliver a letter from General Webb's headquarters at Fort Edward. Montcalm returns Hawkeye but keeps the letter. Montcalm requests a meeting with Monroe, but Monroe is bitter because he has not received reinforcements and sends Hayward in his place. Montcalm reminds Hayward of his superiority and suggests the English surrender the fort. Hayward learns nothing about the letter and takes a request back to Monroe from Montcalm asking for a meeting. When Hayward gets back to Monroe, all Monroe wants to speak about is Hayward's interest in his daughters. He is angered when he finds that Hayward is interested in Alice, not his older daughter Cora. He then accuses Hayward of being prejudiced against Cora, because Cora's mother, whom Monroe met and married in the West Indies, had a grandmother who was once a slave. Later, after Cora's mother had died, Monroe had returned to Ireland where he'd married Alice's mother. Then abruptly, Monroe switches his interest to the message from Montcalm. Monroe marches to meet Montcalm, who hands him the letter from General Webb, which says that no reinforcements are being sent. Monroe agrees to vacate the fort the following morning if his company is allowed to leave with its arms, colors, and baggage. Before they leave, Mangua, who is now working with the French, tries to shoot Monroe, but Montcalm stops him. Mangua tells him that the Indian allies of the French want to take many more English scalps. Montcalm tries to calm Mangua down with little success. As the British begin to evacuate, the women, children, and David Gamet, who has been assigned by Monroe to watch his daughters, trail behind the troops. As they pass near the Indians, one Indian grabs the shawl of a woman. When she objects, he grabs her baby from her arms, dashes its head against a rock, then kills the woman with a tomahawk. At that dangerous moment, Cooper writes, Mangua placed his hands to his mouth and raised the fatal and appalling whoop. The scattered Indians started at the well-known cry as coursers bound at the signal to quit the goal. And directly there rose such a yell along the plain and through the arches of the wood as seldom burst from human lips before. More than 2,000 raging savages broke from the forest at the signal. Death was everywhere, and in his most terrific and disgusting aspects, the flow of blood might be likened to the outbreaking of a torrent. And as the savages became heated and maddened by the sight, many among them even kneeled to the earth and drank freely, exultingly, hellishly of the crimson tide. Alice faints, and Gamet suddenly begins singing a psalm that startles the Indians and keeps he and the girls safe until Mangua, unable to find and kill Monroe, grabs Alice and rushes into the forest, followed by Cora and Gamet. Mangua forces the girls and Gamet to mount horses and rides off with them. They ride to the top of the mountain and watch the massacre. This is the bloodiest section of the novel, which Cooper uses to illustrate the difference between savagery and civilized conduct. 3 days later, Hawkeye, the Mohicans, Monroe, and Hayward return to the scene of the massacre. There they see evidence that the girls and Gamet have survived and have somehow made their way into the wilderness. They suspect Mangua is involved. Cooper's description of the battle scene is horrifying. Hawkeye says the massacre goes far beyond justification, while Monroe, Hayward, and Uncas want to immediately go after the girls. Hawkeye, however, convinces them to wait until the next morning. That evening, it's decided that the group should begin their journey by canoe. The next day, they suddenly find themselves face to face with several canoes filled with Hurons. As they are being chased, Hawkeye finally shoots a Huron, and the Hurons give up the chase. After taking precautions that they won't be found by the Hurons again, they finally reach their destination, hide the canoe under some brush, and begin their hunt for Cora and Alice. For a while, there's no sign of the girls. Finally, Uncas finds some footprints made by horses and follows them to an abandoned campfire site. There, all the clues vanish until Uncas dams up a stream to divert the flow of the water and discovers a moccasin print. Later, he finds a footprint in the moss and realizes that Mangua and the girls have abandoned their horses. Later, he learns that the girls have been transported by a crude handbarrow-type device, of which he finds fragments. Nearing a Huron camp, Hayward is left behind near a beaver pond as an observer. When he sees a person in the woods, he tells Hawkeye, who plans to silence whoever it is. It turns out to be David Gamet, dressed in a combination of white man's and Indian's garments. While the previous part of the book has been full of action, this section is all silence. As the party continues quietly through the woods, Hawkeye thinks how bitter he is at Montcalm for doing nothing to keep the Indians from slaughtering the helpless women and children of the fort. All along, Uncas continues to be the Indian hero by making discoveries that help the party pursue the girls. During this trip, Hawkeye's ability as a tracker seems to be questioned by Cooper. 3 times he loses the trail, only to have Uncas find it. David Gamet's appearance is amusing to Hawkeye, who silently laughs at how ridiculous he looks wearing Indian and white man's clothing. But he's glad to find out from David that the girls are all right. Alice is being detained by the Hurons nearby, while Cora is at a distant village of neighboring Indians. David is allowed to roam freely because the Indians think he is crazy and believe that the Great Spirit protects those who are feeble-minded. Hawkeye and the 2 Mohicans are quite interested when David speaks of the neighboring tribe where Cora is kept. They believe he might be describing a Delaware tribe. Hawkeye and the Mohicans have been friendly with the Delawares in the past. Suddenly, Duncan comes up with a plan to free Alice. Duncan decides to act like he is totally crazy in order to freely circulate among the Hurons as David has done. Chingachgook paints him so that he looks friendly and slightly silly. David and Duncan approach the village, which is not guarded because the Indians are so far from the battle zone they feel secure. The 2 men walk into the principal lodge of the village, where the most important leaders in the tribe are sitting. One of the oldest chiefs discusses their reason for being in the village. At that point, Duncan decides to make the Indians believe he is a Frenchman who is a primitive physician, a healer much like a medicine man. Just then, the discussion was interrupted by the return of a war party. 1 man is carrying a pole with several human scalps displayed on it. A squaw adds brush to the fire, illuminating the area. The 2 white men see 2 captives who are about to be forced to run a gauntlet through the Indians of the village. 1 man looks strong and erect, the other looks scared. The strong and erect man leaps over some children and makes it through the line. The weaker of the 2 makes it safely also, but only because Duncan, who is close to the gauntlet, trips a Huron warrior who is about to land a crippling blow. It turns out that the strongest of the 2 is Uncas, while the other captive is a young Huron brave known as Reed That Bends. The young Huron goes directly into the council lodge, while Uncas is led in. The Huron council sits much as it had for Duncan and David's visit. The Indians show respect for Uncas daring, then focus their attention on the young Huron, who is addressed by name. They call Reed that Ben's a coward by saying his enemy knows the shape of his back and have never seen the color of his eyes. The verdict is announced. Your name will never again be mentioned in this tribe. It is already forgotten, the judge says. Then the young man rises to his feet and bares his chest. The judge kills him by slowly passing a keen, glittering knife into his body. A squaw extinguishes the torch, and the Indians file out of the lodge. At first, Duncan thinks he is alone in the lodge with the dead Indian, but he's mistaken. Uncas approaches him and whispers that Monroe and Chingachgook are safe, and the rife of Hawkeye is not asleep. Then Uncas pushes Duncan from the lodge for his safety. Duncan returns to the council lodge after the warriors have reassembled. He is asked if his medicine is strong enough to help one of the wives of the young warriors who is sick. He says he will try to help her. Before Duncan can leave the lodge, a powerful warrior enters. It is Mangua. For a while, Mangua does not realize that Uncas is a captive, but when Mangua identifies Uncas by his French name, Le Cerf Agile, the nimble deer, there is great stir in the tent, because Uncas is well known to the Hurons. Mangua's oratory is so excitable that it causes one warrior to throw his tomahawk at Uncas. Mangua manages to deflect the tomahawk with his arm because he wants to torture Uncas. Finally, Duncan is escorted by the chief to a cave where the sick Indian maiden is lying. He is followed at a distance by a bear. With the ill Indian maiden is David, who says that Alice, who is in a nearby cave, has been expecting Duncan. While the bear stands in the background, Hayward pretends to heal the woman. Every now and then, the bear lets out a fierce growl. Soon the Huron chief leaves the cave, and Duncan finds himself alone with the sick woman and the bear. Suddenly, the bear waddles over to him and seats himself like a man. Then the bear reaches up toward its head and takes it off, revealing the smiling face of Hawkeye. Hawkeye explains that he's placed Monroe and Chingachgook in an old beaver lodge on the trail to the village. Then he went to an Indian camp where he found an Indian medicine man dressed in the bear costume. He wrapped the Indian over the head and borrowed his costume. Next, Hawkeye tells Duncan that Alice is awaiting him in the next chamber. Duncan finds her and starts to propose marriage to her, but she stops him, saying that any proposal must be made in the presence of her father. Suddenly, Duncan feels a tap on the shoulder. It is Mangua, who is blocking his escape. Then, just as suddenly, the bear appears, puts Mangua in a bear hug, and the two men tie him securely. Duncan, carrying Alice, convinces some of the nearby Indians that he's carrying the sick squaw and escapes. Hawkeye goes back to help Uncas, still disguised as a bear. First, Hawkeye finds David. Then he finds Uncas and cuts his bonds, and the three men plan a strategy of escape. Since David is considered mentally incompetent, he is virtually ignored by the Indians. Hawkeye changes clothes with David, and Uncas puts on the bear costume. David sits in Uncas' place while the new bear and the new David escape into the forest. Several Hurons peek into the tent to see Uncas. When they see David stretch out his legs, they think something has happened to deform their captive. But a closer look reveals that the person there is David, and the whole village explodes at the news of Uncas' escape. Soon the Indian squaw is found dead, and Mangua is released. He tells the Hurons that Hawkeye has been in the camp and speaks so eloquently that he's put in charge of finding the escaped prisoners. Having been told that the prisoners have gone to the Delaware village where Cora is being held, Mangua leads the search party single file. As they pass the beaver dam, a humorous episode occurs. One Huron, whose personal symbol is the beaver, stops and speaks to the beavers. When he's finished, a head pokes out of the door of the beaver lodge. It is Chingachgook, who is wearing the head of a large beaver. After a considerable journey, Mangua and his forces arrive at the Delaware Indian camp. Mangua tells the Delawares he wants to take Cora back to the Huron camp, but the Delawares refuse. Then Mangua tells them that Hawkeye, La Longue Carbine, the long rifle, is with them. After a council of chiefs, there is a meeting of the nation, some 1,000 Delawares strong. At the meeting, two old men appear, assisting one even older. He is Tamenund, the respected patriarch of the Delawares, who is more than 100 years old. Tamenund is placed on a high platform, and four of the five prisoners are brought in. Cora and Alice stand in front. Hayward is near them, and Hawkeye is a bit to the rear. The aged chiefs ask which one is La Longue Carbine. To delay and protect the others, Hayward answers in such a way that the Indians believe he is Hawkeye. Then Hawkeye speaks for himself, leaving the Indians confused over who the real Hawkeye is. After two shooting tests, one decisively by Hawkeye, the Indians realize he is actually Hawkeye. Continuing his efforts to secure Cora, Mangua delivers a speech flattering the Delawares and their history. Although not impressed by Mangua's speech, Tamanan tells him to take Cora and go. But before Mangua can take her, Cora rushes to Tamanan to beg him to spare her sister and to tell him that there is one of his tribe who is not present but must be heard from before he decides what to do with the prisoners. Tamanan, slowed by age, says, "Let him come." Uncas appears and speaks with the tongue of a Delaware. Tamanan is surprised by Uncas because he believes he is hearing a voice from the past. Then, since Uncas is assigned to the dreadful trial of torture by fire, one of the warriors seizes his shirt and rips it off his body. Startled, the warrior points to the figure of a small tortoise tattooed on Uncas' breast. Uncas, with the air of a king, advances to the front and says he is Uncas, the son of Chingachgook. Tamanan is exalted. He realized that he is looking at the grandson of his ancient close friend, Uncas, the ancient leader of the Mohicans. Uncas introduces Hawkeye and says that Hawkeye has fought on the side of the Delawares and never knowingly harmed a member of the tribe. Tamanan then asks Mangua if he had conqueror's rights over Uncas, Hawkeye, Alice, and Hayward. Uncas denies any such right. When Uncas is asked if Mangua has a conqueror's right over Cora, whom Uncas loves, Uncas is silent and Mangua says, "Mohican, you know she is mine." Mangua refuses to exchange his conqueror's rights to Cora for Hawkeye's promise that he would remove himself from the warfare. Knowing that the Delawares will come after him, he leaves with Cora. Once Mangua leaves the Delaware camp, Uncas takes charge. He takes his tomahawk and strikes it into a post that is the emblem of the Hurons. It is the announcement that he will lead the expedition to rescue Cora. This is the first time we've seen Uncas assert himself. Previously, he's only spoken after Chingachgook and Hawkeye have finished. The next morning, the Delawares, who are being watched, as Hawkeye expects, by the Hurons, divide into several parties, with Hawkeye leading one group and Duncan with him. As more than 200 Delaware move into the forest, they are met by David, who tells them the Hurons are hidden in the forest and that Cora has been left in a cave. Hawkeye leaves with a party of 20 rifles, planning a scissors drive with Uncas' party against the Hurons. David follows the group, armed only with a slingshot. For some time, there is no sight of the Hurons. Then a shot rings out, killing a Delaware, and the war is on. At first, the battle goes against Hawkeye's group. But when they near where Uncas is located, things change. Hawkeye and Hayward lead a charge that sweeps away the Hurons. Soon, Hawkeye and Hayward are shooting at the Hurons from one side, while Chingachgook and Monroe, who have joined the fight, have them in a crossfire from the other. Just then, Uncas comes on the scene with 100 warriors, and the Hurons are all but finished. Uncas then takes off after Mangua, who heads toward the cave where Cora is held. With the help of two Hurons, Mangua takes Cora out of the back entrance of the cave onto the side of a mountain. Cora stops on the ledge and says, "I will go no farther. Kill me if thou wilt." Mangua raises his knife to strike her, but hesitates. Above him, Uncas lets out a blood-curdling yell, then leaps to the ledge where Mangua and Cora are. Mangua steps back, and one of the other Hurons stabs Cora, killing her. Then Mangua stabs Uncas in the back. Using his last bit of strength, Uncas strikes at Cora's murderer. But his endurance is gone, and Uncas can't prevent Mangua from stabbing him in the chest three times, killing him. Mangua attempts to escape, but when he tries to leap from one part of the rocks to another, he comes up short. As he is falling, Hawkeye, who's been watching from a distance, draws his rifle, Killdeer, and unloads its contents into the Huron's body. Mangua falls, cutting the air with head downward. Following the three deaths, the Delawares are in mourning. Cora's body is covered with Indian robes. At her feet is seated her unhappy father. Uncas is placed in a seated position, dressed in the most gorgeous ornaments that the wealth of the tribe can provide. Since they had died together, it's believed by the Indians that Cora and Uncas will be traveling to the afterworld together. Looking at his son's grave, Chingachgook says that he is alone. "No, no," cries Hawkeye. "No, Sagamore, not alone. The gifts of our colors may be different, but God has so placed us as to journey the same path. I have no kin, and I may also say, like you, no people. He was your son, and a redskin by nature, and it may be that your blood was nearer. But if ever I forget the lad who has so often fought at my side in war and slept at my side in peace, may he who has made us all, whatever may be our color or our gifts, forget me. The boy has left us for a time, but Sagamore, you are not alone." Tamenund then sends the Indians to their lodges. He is proud to say that he has lived to see the last warrior of the wise race of the Mohicans, as the story ends. The Last of the Mohicans is significant because it's the best of James Fenimore Cooper's works, and because it literally put American literature on the map. In 1820, Sidney Smith, who denounced everything American, wrote in the Edinburgh Review, "In the four quarters of the globe, who reads an American book?" But by 1826, when The Last of the Mohicans was published, much had changed, thanks to Cooper, who's been called the first American novelist. Cooper wasn't the first American to write a novel, but he was the first American to make a long and successful career of it. In many ways, it was Cooper who gave American writers credibility and opened their work to the world.
This is the end of the session.